How did the internet begin? When did we first use the internet? But more importantly, what is the internet? I mean, yes, it's this big wide network that allows not only people, but governments, organizations, universities, and so on to communicate with one another. But it is also this deep ocean of digital information that travels around the world. So how deep is this digital sea of information? If we were to download the entire internet, it would take us approximately 11 trillion years. Yes, you heard me right, 11 trillion years. But that's not the point. My question still remains. How did the internet begin? World War II, also known as the Second World War, was a global war that lasted from 1939 to 1945. The 40 to 50 million deaths during the time makes it the bloodiest as well as the largest war in history. However, a year after the World War was over, the United States and the United Kingdom found themselves with this huge military and intelligence apparatus that had completely become useless. And what do you do when you have equipment worth millions of dollars that immediately becomes useless? You find a way to put the equipment back to use, and that's exactly what happened. Precisely a year after the war was over, the United States and the United Kingdom on 5th March 1946 signed the British-US Intelligence Agreement, also known as the UK-USA Agreement. By 1955, the formal status of the UK-USA Agreement was officially extended to the Five Eyes Intelligence Alliance, comprising of the United Kingdom, United States, Canada, Australia, and New Zealand, all part of the Global Surveillance Program. During the Cold War, the Echelon Program was developed by the Five Eyes to observe and monitor military and diplomatic communications of the Soviet Union and the Eastern Bloc. However, towards the end of the 20th century, the Echelon Program that was once developed to observe and monitor diplomatic and military communications of the Soviet Union extended far beyond its capability to monitor and observe private and commercial communications. Now, the question is, where do we stand today in the midst of this great historic process? Think of some of the biggest companies of the world today. There's Google, Amazon, Apple, Facebook, all big tech. We are more than just users or customers for these businesses. We are generators of data, because the more that we use them, the more data we produce. The world today is in the middle of a great race for data, and big tech companies are on the chase. There's a new type of land grab going on, and it's not land that's being grabbed. It's us, human life at its best. I mean, you look at all the end user license agreements that we simply check the I agree box for. What rights are we actually giving away? Why are these user agreements so lengthy and so complicated? It is by design that we're asked to agree to something that we don't even understand. Who knows what rights we're giving away? It's not just data, it's personal property. Look at social media today. What social media has done, at least in the last decade, is undeniably shape narratives. We're all witnessing how big of a role the entire social media platform is playing in the COVID-19 pandemic. Fake news, fake politics, fake reports, fake gossip, all comes out as a product of the social media platform with algorithm at its core. And without the existence of any regulatory mechanism, the result is nothing but mass manipulation. We are generators of data, and the more data we produce, the more we're adding up to the mechanisms of artificial intelligence. Just like its name, artificial intelligence is a secondary intelligence that works by studying all possible outcomes for a certain task and choosing the best one. For AI to work at optimum capacity, the human brain and human consciousness, above all, must be studied. That is why we're seeing more of these interactive media programs coming up. Facebook introducing the happy, sad, angry, love, care, smileys, and emojis to understand how we react to certain things. Netflix introducing their interactive media programs where you actually choose how to react in certain situations. For instance, being attacked by a lion, what do you do? Do you run away or do you fight? All part of the greater race to acquire AI. But there is a lot at stake. It's not just social media anymore. It's human consciousness. It is not wrong to suggest that the internet in full game mode will have every detail of our life uploaded somewhere up in the cloud. Google Maps, Facebook, WhatsApp, and it doesn't stop there. AI has now become an immensely important component of the marketing campaign. Some call it surveillance capitalism. You are talking to your friends about going on a holiday to Bali maybe. What happens next? As soon as you reach home and open your phone, you see ads coming up for hotel bookings and adventure packages. How do you explain that? There's only one possible answer. Your phone actively listening to you and understanding your consciousness. What we're talking about here, this mobile phone, is quite possibly one of the biggest signals intelligence operations in the history of the modern world. With all this data that is being produced and all this information that must be processed, the world now is required to adapt to better and faster internet speed. And that is where 5G comes in. The internet has evolved into something much bigger now, but it is also a critical opportunity to win the technological race. An investment worth billions of dollars, all resting to be grabbed. First come, first serve. But there's a lot at stake. It's not just the internet, it's human life. Therefore, the word colonialism is the only word to describe the process. Whoever controls 5G controls the world.